Sunday, March 20th, 2:33 p.m. I'm going to read Chapter 9 of Part 3 of Book 4, of Silence and Secrecy and of the Barbarous Names of Evocation. It is found by experience, confirming the statement of Zoroaster, that the most potent conjurations are those in an ancient and perhaps forgotten language, or even those couched in corrupt and possibly always meaningless jargon. Of these, there are several main types. The preliminary invocation in the Goetia consists principally of corruptions of Greek and Egyptian names. For example, we find Asaurinophris for Asaur-un-Nefer. See Liber Samec. This is an edition of this invocation, with an elaborate rubric, translation, scholia, and instruction. The conjurations given by D are in a language called Angelic or Enochian. See Liber 84 of Elchnach. Its source has hitherto baffled research, but it is a language and not a jargon, for it possesses a structure of its own, and there are traces of grammar and syntax. In any case, it is probably corrupt. However this may be, it works. Even the beginner finds that things happen when he uses it, and this is an advantage or disadvantage shared by no other type of language. The rest needs skill. This needs prudence. The Egyptian invocations are much purer, but their meaning has not been sufficiently studied by persons magically competent. We possess a number of invocations in Greek of every degree of excellence, in Latin but a few, and those of inferior quality. It will be noticed that in every case the conjurations are very sonorous, and there is a certain magical voice in which they should be recited. This special voice was the natural gift of the master Therion, but it can be easily taught to the right people. Various considerations impelled him to attempt conjuration in the English language. There already existed one example, the charm of the witches in Macbeth. Although this was perhaps not meant seriously, its effect is indubitable. A true poet cannot help revealing himself in the truth of things in his art, whether he be aware of what he is writing or no. He has found iambic tetrameters enriched with many rhymes, both internal and external, very useful. The Wizard Way in The Winged Beetle gives a good idea of the sort of thing. So does the evocation of Bartzabel in the Equinox. There are many extant invocations throughout his works, in many kinds of meter, of many kinds of being, and for many kinds of purposes. See Appendix 1, Examples of Ritual. Other methods of incantation are on record as efficacious. For instance, Frater I.A., when a child, was told that he could invoke the devil by repeating the Lord's Prayer backwards. He went into the garden and did so. The devil appeared and almost scared him out of his life. It is therefore not quite certain in what the efficacy of conjurations really lies. The peculiar mental excitement required may be aroused by the perception of the absurdity of the process, and the persistence in it. As when once Frater Perdurabo, at the end of his magical resources, recited from Greenland's icy mountains and obtained his result. It may be conceded in any case that the long strings of formidable words which roar and moan through so many conjurations have a real effect in exalting the consciousness of the magician to the proper pitch. That they should do so is no more extraordinary than that of music of any kind should do so. Magicians have not confined themselves to the use of the human voice. The panpipe, with its seven stops corresponding to the seven planets, the bull roarer, the tom-tom, and even the violin have all been used, as well as many others, of which the most important is the bell. Though this is used not so much for actual conjuration as to mark stages in the ceremony. See Part 2. It should be said that in experience no bell save his own Tibetan bell of Electrum Magicum has ever sounded satisfactory to the Master Therion. Most bells jar and repel. Of all these, the tom-tom will be found to be the most generally useful. While on the subject of barbarous names of evocation, we should not omit the utterance of certain supreme words, words which enshrine A, the complete formula of the god invoked, or B, the whole ceremony. Examples of the former kind are Tetragrammaton, IAO, and Abrahadabra. An example of the latter kind is the great word, Stibitchefmifsis, which is a line drawn on the Tree of Life, Coptic attributions, in a certain manner. It represents the descent of a certain influence. See the evocation of Taphtartharath. This word expresses the current Kether, Beth, Bina, Cheth, Jebra, Mem, Hod, Shin, Malkuth, the descent from 1 to 10 via the Pillar of Severity. With all such words, it is most important that they should never be spoken until the supreme moment, and even then they should burst from the magician almost despite himself, so great should be his reluctance to utter them. This reluctance is Freudian, due to the power of these words to awaken the suppressed subconscious libido. In fact, they should be the utterance of the god in him at the first onset of the divine possession. So uttered, they cannot fail of effect, for they have become the effect. Every wise magician will have constructed, according to the principles of the Holy Kabbalah, many such words, and he should have quintessentialized them in one word, which last word, once he has formed it, he should never utter consciously, even in thought, until perhaps with it he gives up the ghost. Such a word should in fact be so potent that men cannot hear it and live. Such a word was indeed the lost Tetragrammaton. The Master Therion has received this word. It is communicated by him to the proper postulants at the proper time and place in the proper circumstances. It is said that at the utterance of this name the universe crashes into dissolution. Let the magician earnestly seek this lost word, for its pronunciation is synonymous with the accomplishment of the great work. Each man has a different great work, just as no two points on the circumference of a circle are connected with the center by the same radius. This word will be correspondingly unique. In this matter of efficacy of words, there are again two formulae exactly opposite in nature. A word may become potent and terrible by virtue of constant repetition. It is in this way that most religions gain strength. At first, the statement, "so and so is God," excites no interest. Continue, and you meet scorn and skepticism, possibly persecution. Continue, and the controversy is so far died out that no one troubles to contradict your assertion. No superstition is so dangerous and so lively as an exploded superstition. The newspapers of today, written and edited almost exclusively by men without a spark of either religion or morality, dare not hint that anyone disbelieves in the ostensibly prevailing cult. They deplore atheism, all but universal in practice and implicit in the theory of practically all intelligent people, as if it were the eccentricity of few negligible or objectionable persons. This is the ordinary story of advertisement. The sham has exactly the same chance as the real. Persistence is the only quality required for success. The opposite formula is that of secrecy. An idea is perpetuated because it must never be mentioned. A Freemason never forgets the secret words entrusted to him. Though these words mean absolutely nothing to him in the vast majority of cases, the only reason for this is that he has been forbidden to mention them, although they have been published again and again, and are as accessible to the profane as to the initiate. In such a work of practical magic as the preaching of a new law, these methods may be advantageously combined. On the one hand, infinite frankness and readiness to communicate all secrets. On the other, the sublime and terrible knowledge that all real secrets are incommunicable. If this were not the case, individuality would not be inviolable. No man can communicate even the simplest thought to any other man in any full and accurate sense, for that thought is sown in a different soil, and cannot produce an identical effect. I cannot put a spot of red upon two pictures without altering each in different ways. It might have little effect on a sunset by Turner, but much on a nocturne by Whistler. The identity of the two spots as spots would thus be fallacious. It is, according to tradition, a certain advantage in conjurations to employ more than one language. In all probability, the reason of this is that any change spurs the flagging attention. A man engaged in intense mental labor will frequently stop and walk up and down the room. One may suppose for this cause, but it is a sign of weakness that this should be necessary. For the beginner in magic, however, it is permissible to employ any device to secure the result. This is not to say that it is advisable. Oh, how shameful is human weakness! But it does not encourage one, it is useless to deny, to be knocked down by a demon of whose existence one was not really quite sure. Conjurations should be recited, not read, and the entire ceremony should be so perfectly performed that one is hardly conscious of any effort of memory. The ceremony should be constructed with such logical fatality that a mistake is impossible. First-rate poetry is easily memorized because the ideas and the musical values correspond to man's mental and sensory structure. The conscious ego of the magician is to be destroyed, to be absorbed in that of the god whom he invokes, and the process should not interfere with the automaton who is performing the ceremony. But this ego of which it is here spoken is the true ultimate ego. The automaton should possess will, energy, intelligence, reason, and resource. This automaton should be the perfect man, far more than any other man can be. It is only the divine self within the man. A self as far above the possession of will or any other qualities whatsoever as the heavens are high above the earth, that should reabsorb itself into that illimitable radiance of which it is a spark. This is said of the partial or lesser works of magic. This is an elementary treatise. One cannot discuss higher works, as for example those of the hermit of Aesopus Island. In order to aid concentration or to increase the supply of energy, it has been customary for the magician to employ assistants or colleagues. It is doubtful whether the obvious advantages of this plan compensate for the difficulty of procuring suitable persons, and the chance of a conflict of will or a misunderstanding in the circle itself. The great difficulty for the single magician is so to perfect himself that these multifarious duties of the ritual are adequately performed. At first he will find that the exaltation destroys memory and paralyzes muscle. This is an essential difficulty of the magical process, and can only be overcome by practice and experience. See the Book of Lies. There are several chapters on this subject. But right exaltation should produce spontaneously the proper mental and physical reactions. As soon as the development is secured, there will be automatic reflex justesse, French precision exactitude, exactly as in normal affairs mind and body respond with free unconscious rightness to the will. The organic development of magic in the world due to the creative will of the Master Therion makes it with every year that passes easier to find scientifically trained co-workers. On one occasion, Frater Perdurabo was disobeyed by an assistant, and had it not been for his promptitude in using the physical compulsion of the sword, it is probable that the circle would have been broken. As it was, the affair fortunately terminated in nothing more serious than the destruction of the culprit. However, there is no doubt that an assemblage of persons who really are in harmony can much more easily produce an effect than a magician working by himself. The psychology of revival meetings will, alas, be familiar to almost everyone. And though such meetings are the foulest and most degraded rituals of black magic, the laws of magic are not thereby suspended. See for an account of properly conducted congregational ceremonial, Liber 811, Energized Enthusiasm, and Liber 15, Ecclesia Gnosticae Catholicae Canon Missae. The revival meetings here in question were deliberate exploitations of religious hysteria by knavish or insanely fanatical adherents of the slave gods who flourished in the days when this book was written. A singular and world-famous example of this is of sufficiently recent date to be fresh in the memory of many people now living. At a nigger camp meeting in the United States of America, these pseudo-human brutes, many of them scarcely superior to their white neighbors, were worked up to such a pitch of excitement that the whole assembly developed a furious form of hysteria. The comparatively intelligible cries of glory and hallelujah no longer expressed the situation. Somebody screamed out, "Tarara boomdie!" And this was taken up by the whole meeting and yelled continuously until reaction set in. The affair got into the papers, and some particularly bright disciple of John Stuart Mill, logician and economist, thought that these words, having set one of the fools crazy, might do the same to all other fools in the world. He accordingly wrote a song and produced the desired result. This is the most notorious example in recent times of the power exerted by a barbarous name of evocation. A few words may be useful to reconcile the general notion of causality with that of magic. How can we be sure that a person waving a stick and howling thereby produces thunderstorms? In no other way than that familiar to science. We know that whenever we put a lighted match to dry gunpowder, an unintelligibly arbitrary phenomena, that of sound, is observed, and so forth. We need not dwell upon this point, but it seems worthwhile to answer one of the objections to the possibility of magic, choosing one which is at first sight of an obviously fatal character. It is convenient to quote verbatim from the diary of the very distinguished magician and philosopher. In a later entry, we find that the diarist has found a similar train of argument in Space, Time, and Gravitation, page 51. He was much encouraged by the confirmation of his thesis in so independent a system of thought. I have noticed that the effect of a magical work has followed it so closely that it must have been started before the time of the work. E.g., I work tonight to make X in Paris write to me. I get the letter the next morning, so that it must have been written before the work. Does this deny that the work caused the effect? If I strike a billiard ball and it moves, both my will and its motion are due to causes long antecedent to the act. I may consider both my work and its reaction as twin effects of the eternal universe. The moved arm and ball are parts of a state of the cosmos which resulted necessarily from its momentarily previous state, and so, back forever. Thus, my magical work is only one of the cause-effects necessarily concomitant with the cause-effects which set the ball in motion. I may therefore regard the act of striking as a cause-effect of my original will to move the ball, though necessarily previous to its motion. But the case of magical work is not quite analogous, for my nature is such that I am compelled to perform magic in order to make my will to prevail, so that the cause of my doing the work is also the cause of the ball's motion, and there is no reason why one should precede the other. C.F. Lewis Carroll, where the Red Queen screams before she pricks her finger. Let me illustrate the theory by an actual example. I wrote from Italy to a man in France and another in Australia on the same day, telling them to join me. Both arrived 10 days later, the first in answer to my letter which he received, the second on his own initiative, as it would seem. But I summoned him because I wanted him, and I wanted him because he was my representative, and his intelligence made him resolve to join me because it judged rightly that the situation, so far as he knew it, was such as to make me desire his presence. The same cause, therefore, which made me to write to him made him come to me. And though it would be improper to say that the writing of the letter was the direct cause of his arrival, it is evident that if I had not written, I should have been different from what I actually am, and therefore my relations with him would have been otherwise than they are. In this sense, therefore, the letter and the journey are causally connected. One cannot go farther and say, in this case, I ought to write the letter even if he had arrived before I did so, for it is part of the whole set of circumstances that I do not use a crowbar on an open door. The conclusion is that one should do one's will without lust of result. If one is working in accordance with the laws of one's own nature, one is doing right, and no such work can be criticized as useless, even in the cases of the character here discussed. So long as one's will prevails, there is no cause for complaint. To abandon one's magic would shew lack of self-confidence in one's powers, and doubt as to one's inmost faith in self and in nature, i.e. on the ground that one cannot understand how magic can produce the desired effects. For if one possesses the inclination to do magic, it is evidence of a tendency in one's nature. Nobody understands fully how the mind moves the muscles, but we know that lack of confidence on this point means paralysis. If the sun and moon should doubt, they'd immediately go out, as Blake said. Also, as I said myself, who hath the how is careless of the why. Of course, one changes one's method as experience indicates, but there is no need to change them on any such ground as the above. Further, the argument here set forth disposes of the need to explain the modus operandi of magic. A successful operation does not involve any theory soever, not even that of the existence of causality itself. The whole set of phenomena may be conceived as single. For instance, if I see a star as it was years ago, I need not assume causal relations as existing between it, the earth, and myself. The connection exists. I can predicate nothing beyond that. I cannot postulate purpose or even determine the manner in which the event comes to be. Similarly, when I do magic, it is in vain to inquire why I so act, or why the desired result does or does not follow, nor can I know how the previous and subsequent conditions are connected. At most, I can describe the consciousness which I interpret as a picture of the facts, and make empirical generalizations of the superficial aspects of the case. Thus I have my own personal impressions of the act of telephoning, but I cannot be aware of what consciousness, electricity, mechanics, sound, etc. actually are in themselves. And although I can appeal to experience to lay down laws as to what conditions accompany the fact, I can never be sure that they have always been, or ever will again be, identical. In fact, it is certain that an event can never occur twice in precisely the same circumstances. If it did so, how can we call it duplex? Further, my laws must always take nearly all the more important elements of knowledge for granted. I cannot say, finally, how an electric current is generated. I cannot be sure that some totally unsuspected force is not at work in some entirely arbitrary way. For example, it was formerly supposed that hydrogen and chlorine would unite when an electric spark was passed through the mixture. Now we know that the presence of a minute quantity of aqueous vapor or some tertium quid, Latin third something, is essential to the reaction. Frater Perturabo's experiments under Professor Hughes at Eastbourne College. We formulated, before the days of Ross, the laws of malarial fever, without reference to the mosquito. We might discover one day that the germ is only active when certain events are transpiring in some nebula, or when so apparently inert a substance as argon is present in the air in certain proportions. The history of the Earth is included in the period of some such relation, so that we cannot possibly be sure that we may deny malarial fever is a function of the present precession of the equinoxes. We may therefore admit quite cheerfully that magic is as mysterious as mathematics, as empirical as poetry, as uncertain as golf, and as dependent on the personal equation as love. That is no reason why we should not study, practice, and enjoy it, for it is a science in exactly the same sense as biology. It is no less an art than sculpture, and it is a sport as much as mountaineering. Indeed, there seems no undue presumption in urging that no science possesses equal possibilities of deep and important knowledge, that no art offers such opportunities to the ambition of the soul to express its truth in ecstasy through beauty, and that no sport rivals its fascination of danger and delight, so excites, exercises, and tests its devotees to the uttermost, or so rewards them by well-being, pride, and the passionate pleasures of personal triumph. Magic is less liable to lead to error than any other science, because its terms are interchangeable by definition, so that it is based on relativity from the start. We run no risk of asserting absolute propositions. Furthermore, we make our measurements in terms of the objects measured, thus avoiding the absurdity of defining metaphysical ideas by mutable standards. Cf. Eddington's Space, Time, and Gravity prologue. of being forced to attribute the qualities of human consciousness to inanimate things. Poincare, La Mesure des Temps, Les Valeurs de la Science, Chapter 2, and of asserting that we know anything of the universe in itself, though the nature of our senses and our minds necessarily determine our observations, so that the limit of our knowledge is subjective, just as a thermometer can record nothing but its own reaction to one particular type of energy. Magic recognizes frankly, 1, that truth is relative, subjective, and apparent, 2, that truth implies omniscience, which is unattainable by mind, being transfinite, just as if one tried to make an exact map of England in England, that map must contain a map of the map, and so on, ad infinitum. 3, that logical contradiction is inherent in reason. Russell, Introduction to Mathematical Philosophy, page 136. Crowley, Eleusis, and elsewhere. 4, that a continuum requires a continuum to be commensurable with it. 5, that empiricism is ineluctable, and therefore that adjustment is the only possible method of action. And 6, that error may be avoided by opposing no resistance to change, and registering observed phenomena in their own language. Magic takes every thought and act for its apparatus. It has the universe for its library and its laboratory. All nature is its subject and its game, free from closed seasons and protective restrictions. Always abounds in infinite variety, being all that exists. The elasticity of magic makes it equal to all possible kinds of environment, and therefore biologically perfect. Do what thou wilt implies self-adjustment, so that failure cannot occur. One's true will is necessarily fitted to the whole universe with the utmost exactitude, because each term in the equation, A plus B plus C equals zero, must be equal and opposite to the sum of all the other terms. No individual can ever be aught than himself, or do aught else than his will, which is his necessary relation with his environment, dynamically considered. All error is no more than an illusion proper to him who perceives it, yet it may be no less natural to him to dissipate the mirage. And it is a general law that the method of accomplishing this operation is to realize and to acquiesce in the order of the universe, and to refrain from attempting the impossible task of overcoming the inertia of the forces which oppose and therefore are identical with oneself. Error in thought is therefore failure to understand, and in action to perform one's own true will. No man but must, willy-nilly, be a magician. His personal problem is this: whether he rank with Lydia Pinkham or Sir William Thompson, Lord Leighton or Franz Hals, Tartarin of Tarascon or Oscar Eckenstein. My own intense absorption in magic has not prevented me from making advances in scientific knowledge which will ere long be recognized as inaugurating an epoch, from being the only English poet of first rank in my generation, and from holding the lion's shares of the world's mountaineering records. Nay, in sooth, it has made me I am that I am.